Hello and welcome to the first in our series of five short lectures on careers in the patents field for engineers and scientists. My name is Mark Dighton. I'm the administrative director of the Patent Office Exam course for an organization called PLI. It stands for Practising Law Institute, but we generally go by PLI in the business. PLI is a nonprofit organization founded almost a century ago. We do a variety of training and educational programs for attorneys and related professionals. PLI's Patent Office Exam course is the oldest and still the leading course to prepare people to pass the Patent Office's registration exam. If you pass the registration exam, you can call yourself a patent agent and represent others, inventors, in front of the Patent Office to help them get patents in the first place. We'll get into the difference between patent agents and patent attorneys in a later video, but for now we're mostly just talking about patent agents. I've run the course, the Patent Office exam course, for more than 20 years now, and we prepare about 1,000 people a year, more than 1,000 people a year really, to pass this exam. I also spent a decade before that teaching law students how to pass the various state bar exams. So I know a lot about preparing people for high-stakes exams, and I know a lot about the business of patents. So we work with kind of all the major law firms and corporations, and the tech transfer offices at the universities now, a very big part of our business. If you've got any further questions while I'm thinking of it, you can reach me at my email address, which is mdighton, M-D-I-G-H-T-O-N, at pli.edu for any further questions. So let's just start with some kind of an introduction of terms that we'll need to understand in order to talk intelligently about this. First, let's start with the big umbrella term, which is IP. Stands for intellectual property. Intellectual property is any kind of intangible property, not like personal property, like you own an object, or real property, like, you know, you own your home. Intangible property can take a variety of different forms, but we generally call them intellectual property. The one that most people have heard of is copyrights. Copyrights is a very particular form of protection of intellectual property. It protects the particular form your expression takes. So we use it mostly for written words, you know, books, articles, anything basically you write is at least in theory copyrighted. You know, songs, paintings, movies, plays, all that kind of thing. But it's only a particular expression of an idea. You cannot copyright an underlying idea. And so someone can come up with something very close to what you've done on their own, just randomly, you know, and you can't sue them for copyright. You can really sue somebody for copyright if you can show that they, in effect, copied your words or your work in some form or another, you know, in whole or in part. The famous case that came up recently was the Bruno Mars case, where they were accused of copying a Marvin Gaye song. And they basically said that they didn't intend to, and maybe they weren't even aware that they were. But basically, the courts deciding that the songs were so similar that there couldn't be any way that you could come up with that similar sounding song without having kind of copied it in some form or another, even if you did it unintentionally. You don't remember the song in particular, but you heard it somewhere and it stayed in the back of your head, and somehow when you wrote your song, you were basically copying it. There's a lot of people who have a lot of debate about whether that case is correctly decided or not. But for, you know, our intents and purposes, at least illustrates what we're talking about here. The next kind of form of intellectual property you might have heard of is a trademark. Trademarks are, you know, logos and things like that used to kind of promote and protect a company's name or brand, that kind of thing. There's also a trade dress, which is a lot less common, but protects a particular look of a product. The famous Coke bottle design is probably the best known trade dress. But also, you know, the Nike swoosh, things like that. that you basically look at that and go, okay, I know this is a Nike product, or, oh, I know this is Coca-Cola, without even looking at the name on the bottle or the shoe, just by looking at that trademark or trade dress. Our real subject today is patents, which is probably the most elevated form of intellectual property, the most difficult form of intellectual property. Patents go beyond just protecting how something looks or how, you know, the exact words you use to express yourself. Patents protect kind of an underlying idea. They protect something you have invented, not just how it looks or how you arrived at it. But it's also more than an idea. You can't patent an idea. There has to be a thing you made or a way that you're doing something, whereby something is accomplished, and that's what you're patenting. The patents are the one thing that actually shows up in the U.S. Constitution. The U.S. Constitution gives the federal government the mandate to protect the useful arts. So the patent has to be for something useful, not just creative or interesting or thought-provoking or the like. All those things are probably covered by copyright or something like that. It has to be something that does something, that accomplishes something, at least in a way that's never been done before. We'll talk more about patents later. We're just, you know, taking the bird's eye view at this point. The real choice in the real world is often really between a patent and a trade secret. Basically, the trade-off is, in order to get a patent, you have to tell the world what you've invented and how you did it. In exchange for that, you get a right protected by the federal government to basically for 20 years, more or less, you get the exclusive right to decide who can use that invention and how. Or they have to pay you money to license the invention, or you're going to sue them for infringement and they're going to pay you that way. After that patent period, basically 20 years, has run out, the invention is dedicated to the public. Hand it over to the public, it becomes a public knowledge thing that you no longer control, and the public can produce and use that invention any way they want without owing you anything. You know, probably the best example most people know is generic drugs. Once a patent expires on a patented drug, it goes off brand, and basically anybody can produce it because the patent tells you how to produce the drug. Trade secrets, on the other hand, last forever, but only if you can keep them secret forever, and that's the problem. Probably the most famous trade secret is the formula for Coca-Cola. You know, I don't know whether all this is true, but at least, you know, in theory, they tell stories. They've gone to great lengths to keep that formula secret. Supposedly, no one person has the whole formula, and pieces of it are kept locked up in super secret vaults somewhere. But the risk is, of course, that somehow that secret, no matter how closely you protect it, is going to get out. And at one point, somebody who actually worked for Coke managed to put the formula together and tried to sell it to Pepsi. Luckily, Pepsi did the honorable thing and just turned them down, and in fact turned them in. I think the person went to jail for it. But if they hadn't, Pepsi would have been able to basically start producing Coca-Cola, a beverage that tastes is for all intents and purposes, Coca-Cola. But keep in mind, they wouldn't be able to call it Coca-Cola because that would violate Coca-Cola's trademark, right? You couldn't even put it, like we talked about trade dress, you couldn't put it in the famous Coke bottle with a different name because that would violate the trade dress Coca-Cola has. You probably couldn't even advertise it as just like Coca-Cola or the same as Coke, but that's kind of a close call. What I can say for sure is that if you tried to do that, Coke would come after you with everything they've got. You'd probably switch pretty quickly to just saying, tastes just like America's number one soft drink, or, you know, is essentially the same as America's number one soft drink. And then your angle, of course, on that is that you just sell it for less than Coke and trust that people will figure out that it tastes exactly like Coke and probably is Coke, and they can save a couple pennies by buying your knockoff. But the trouble with the trade secret is that once you've decided it's a trade secret, you can't go back later and get a patent on it. If you've been using your trade secret out in the public, usually more than a year, you basically forfeit your right to ever get a patent on it. Basically, the patent system is, you tell us now what you're doing, and in exchange we give you 20 years of protection, and then everybody gets it. So, you know, Coke couldn't wait until somebody was about to, you know, publish the formula, and then all of a sudden decide to go get a patent. Now, the only thing that keeps the secret, you know, the trade secret safe is that it is, in fact, a secret. And you know, so, you know, most serious businesses go for a patent over a trade secret, since most things aren't as easy to hide as the formula for Coke. I mean, I defy you to tell me what's in Coke other than sugar and food coloring. Most inventions, an expert could look at it and at least figure out how the thing works, and then you could go copy it that way. So there are very few real trade secrets in the world, and the reason everybody uses Coca-Cola as an example is that it's probably the only one that's really worked for a very long time. So those are the kind of the forms of intellectual property, but what we're really going to be talking about is patents. We'll talk later about patent agents and what they do and what that means as opposed to a patent attorney. But let's just say for now, just to kind of put that nagging question in the back of your mind, is that basically if you pass the patent office's registration exam, you can call yourself a patent agent. A patent attorney not only has to pass that special exam given by the patent office, but it has to go to law school and have passed at least one state bar exam before they can call themselves a patent attorney, as we'll talk about it here. So I think that defines the terms. In the next video, we're going to be talking about the work that patent agents do, so you can hopefully get a taste of whether you would like to do that kind of thing. So I'll see you, I hope, in the next video. Thank you.